actually begin with what it means, like my definition of it, and what are the different types of information design outputs, and then we can talk about infographics specifically. So, by definition, it is information design is a dedicated field for communicating complex data or information efficiently to any given audience. So basically, you're looking at information that is important to be given, and which is too complicated to be given at one go. So, which is why you need to design it in a way that is easy for somebody to comprehend. And so these are information which are maybe maps, or maybe bank forms, or maybe instruction manuals. These are all kind of complicated information, not something that you can easily understand it when it's put together all in the same place. So, which is why you're trying to efficiently communicate it. So in the definition, there are some three keywords that have been highlighted. One is the communicating complex data or information. Second, it has to be efficient. Third, it's for a specific audience. These are the three things we always need to keep in mind designing any kind of an infographic or any information design output. Who are you designing it for? We need to make sure it's effectively and efficiently conveyed. And make sure that the information itself is processed properly. So one way to think about it is that we're selecting and organizing and presenting that information. Another is that you're conveying it in the most accurate and unbiased form, and also that you're capturing the essence of what you need to convey, that the message has to go through, and whoever is interpreting it interprets it in the way that it's intended to be. So information design can be of several forms. This is not even an exhaustive list of it. It could be instruction manuals, things that you see when you open your, say, medicines, and there are sometimes these instructions on following that. Equipments, your electronics that you buy have always come with these instruction manuals, sometimes with diagrammatic instruction manuals. Scientific diagrams in books are a form of information design. Signage systems are a very important form of information design. Everything in the airports is a good system of signage that has several different levels of communicating things. The forms that we're talking about are, say, bank forms, or forms that you fill out for putting your information in for any kind of application. So everything, again, they're asking you for a lot of information. It has to be put together in one page. It has to be as simply conveyed as possible. So it's again important information design example. There are also maps. So maps are again information design. Infographics are again information design. What tells about infographics from information design is that infographics would be, say, one or two composition put together when conveying a complex concept. So, we'll just go through visually some examples. These are again instruction manuals. This particular one is like how to assemble a chair from IKEA. IKEA usually is known for its instruction manuals. They use a no text based instruction manual, so there is not even a word of text, because what they mean is it's for everyone. So anybody who reads any language or cannot read is also able to assemble the furniture. So this is like one of the pages, but if you try and look up instruction manuals, you'll find a lot of examples of IKEA instruction manuals. Scientific examples again, labeling. Things that we've been doing in Inkscape a lot are also information design. Signage systems. Signage systems again come at different levels. There are places which use icons to show signages, arrows to show signages, and also then different places use different placement for signages. And we won't go into the detail, but lots to learn there as well. Forms again. So how to, as clearly as possible, segregate information and present it in a form so that it doesn't look scary. People usually fail to create good information design for forms. Maps, of course, are a very useful, effective information design example. Infographics. So this, I think, a particular one uses different ways of representing different information. It used a combination of charts and maps and bar graphs. So I think, again, a simple definition of infographics would be visual representation of information, data or knowledge intended to present information quickly and clearly. So again, some keywords being information, data and knowledge, quickly and clearly, again being efficiency being the keyword. The two things to be noted about infographics are the subjectivity and storytelling. Subjectivity about any information that you have is always part of your presentation of that information. It's very impossible to present something objectively, but then you should be mindful of the way you're putting out the information, making sure that you are, whatever information you've chosen to show is ethical in a way, and also telling the most truthful story according to you as much as possible. Storytelling again is what infographics are all about. So what we try to do today is also some storytelling kind of exercises. What we need to understand is that whenever you're presenting information, the first thing you're trying to do is creating a narrative. So if you have a certain message to convey through that information, that should be your primary target to achieve. And then how you use that information to convey that message is what we're trying to learn. This is one good example of an infographic. It's not very clear on the projector here, but I can share the slides with you anyway. It's basically about 10 most dangerous countries for journalists, basically the journalist deaths that have happened in various countries. It's for a specific year from 2015. And so the idea is to use the regional the map, because the information is regional. So it's easier to show it through a map, because some people can easily perceive it. Another good thing that they've done is, instead of using just numbers for each country, they've used dots here, because then you're easily able to identify which is the largest, which is the country with the largest number of deaths and the second largest. You're able to tell just visually without having to count anything or look at numbers and process it. So this is the quickest way of processing this information. So this is an example. You can also check more of these. Okay, so I think these are some steps that we can follow perhaps while you're making any infographics. One is to identify what type of data you actually have. Sometimes it could be, say, categories like number of males or number of females in something, people in different regions that we saw just now. It could be ordinal. Ordinal is usually means in order of something. So sometimes when you conduct these surveys, when you have questionnaires and they ask you, you know, how did you find the food? Good, very good, reasonable, very bad, something like that. So those answers can be then recorded as ordinal data. Quantitative data, of course, which is any kind of numerical data. Relational data. Relational data is when you associate one entity with in relation to other entities. So some kind of a network diagram would be a good example of relational data. Spatial data is, of course, maps. Anything that you kind of record according to regions, according to different countries is can be spatial data. Continuous data is when you record a data from one point in time to another point in time or different points in time, and you have data then, like a timeline could be an example of that. Any questions so far? Can you move on? So there is the second step would be to identify the purpose. So if you know what kind of data you have, the second thing you need to know is, what do I need to show? Is it a comparative diagram? Am I showing that something is higher than the other? Am I trying to show that there is, what kind of a relationship there is between the data that I have? there's hierarchy that you want to show, there is how something works, so are you labeling something, are you showing the processes, the flowcharts would be something like that, movements and flows of something, patterns, different, something that has happened and changing over time or changing through regions could be a pattern that you're trying to highlight, different concepts that you're trying to explain or locations that you're trying to explain, part two holes, pie charts are a classic example of part two hole. We'll talk about pie charts in more detail. Distribution of something and range of the data that you're trying to show, data over time that you're trying to show. These are various ways of what the purpose of your infographic could be. These are all actually available on certain sources. So I've listed the sources along with the slides. If you go to those, you'll find much more detail about all of these purpose or these kind of formats. So this is again something that is most practical for now. These are a kind of a list of all the different formats that there could be for representing quantitative data. So this is something that's been recorded in a resource called Data Wish Catalog. It's again listed under the slide. They just show you, they just ask you the three questions that I've put up here. They'll ask you those questions. They'll ask you what kind of data you have. They'll ask you what purpose you have. And then they'll suggest you the formats that, you can use. So this is something, they won't help you creating those formats, but at least you can come to the decision of making those formats. So this is an easy way of going about representing graphs or pie charts or other kinds of formats. So, I mean, it's a huge list, so I won't go through all of it, but you can check out the resource and, of course, see whatever suits you the time. So this is a infographic about an infographic. This is basically how to think visually, and they categorize the different formats that you can use in four different categories. And it's pretty much a similar kinds of format that we saw in the previous slide, but this again can help you decide which suits you better according to the data that you have. Then we'll just go through some quick examples of some infographics and find out what's good about them, what's bad about them. So one of them is, this is called a heat map. So if you've seen it before, it's basically trying to show the through a gradation of colors, what is least prominent and most prominent in your pattern. So this is a good way of showing pattern of some sort or showing the gradation that this is the clearly the most prominent kind of element in your design. So this particular one is about the decline of workers' compensation in the year, through the years 2002 to 2014. They've plotted it along horizontally, and the different gradation of colors show the cut of the payment and the payment that they usually used to have. So this is a network diagram example again. I think very clear on what it's trying to convey maybe, but it's trying to show satellites and the different network of satellites. I'm not very sure if it's according to region or if it's according to some chronology that they're trying to represent, but I mean the basic idea of this is how to represent something when you want to show a network. This is again an example of a timeline. I just wanted to show this because classically the timeline would be just horizontal or just vertical and it would just with some points marked along. This one kind of also demarcates the information in four different ways and uses that kind of a format to convey two kinds of information. So they're trying to layer more information, make it more convenient for the reader. This is one of my favorite. So it's very simple. There's nothing going on there. It's just chronology. But they've used these little icons and pictograms to just show the ages of different animals. So you're able to quickly spot everything, and everything you can clearly see in one go in the infographic, which is like the simplest way of representing, but really, really effective. It's also a really old infographic. So it's been created in 1939, and the kind of icons that we've used is called isotype. it's a specific type of technique that was created for standardized pictograms. So that's something if you're interested in, you can always.
What does it mean? Proprietary name.
It's actually like a set of icons, which are proprietary. People can use it, but they were discovered at the time so that they can standardize the visuals of these icons. So they created these for the Olympics actually, and then they got incorporated as a standard way of representing any kind of icon, animals, all signages, men, women, sticker guys, that kind of.
But it's not up to scale.
Yeah. I think they've not used it up to scale. Usually, I think there's a standard guideline that you get for the purpose. So, yeah, this was one. This is again a very effective way of showing something. This is actually a wind map. So, what they've done is they've taken the map of the USA and they've shown the intensity of wind through the lines. So, again, if we do a little callback to lines, again, a good way of using that intensity to show, representing something basically. So wherever the intensity is less, is low wind again, and then there's wherever it's more intense, it's shown by higher intensity of the lines also.
But this again is used in that animated website.
Yeah, it's an
animated. Where you can see the direction.
But
when you take a still, you don't.
Yeah, you can't see that. It's actually, it gives a lot more information when you go through the interactive one, because I think it moves also.
It moves.
It's a really simple, again, example, not using too many numbers, not using too many symbols, but simply just lines can help you show a lot of things. So, another thing is using elements according to the purpose that you have. So, this is like a quick graph that's also available in one of the websites that tells you according to the kind, amount of accuracy that you need in your graphs, what kind of format you can use. So, starting with say more like generic kind of showing, if you just want to show that I have these many of one kind, you use color differentiation, but you necessarily are not showing the numbers. Another is that if you use these kind of things like areas, bigger circles, smaller circles, you're again not telling them the exact number, but they're able to gauge how much of something, how much quantity of some kind of specific element is used. Color intensity is again a similar way of using that. So the heat map example that you saw used color intensity. Slopes are a little more specific. So as we go higher, we are getting more and more accurate about the information that we are sharing. So slopes will plot the exact point. So you are getting more information through that. There are two slopes, then you are comparing two kind of information. The most accurate way of representing something is bar graphs, because you are using accurate numbers and you are showing them also to the heights of the graph bar. So, that's about that. Then, this is something I quickly go over. It's called, usually there's a lot of criticism about pie charts. So, the accuracy of pie charts is always questioned, the amount of information that it gives is always questioned. If we try to compare a pie chart and a bar graph, we can see what difference there is in the information that it allows you to. So we can read through it. One quick example is that one is very clear on the kind of amounts, quantity there is. The pie chart won't help you a lot with that. It will just give you a relational idea of how much percentage each of the things have on the pie. So you can check more on this. There's a website source again for this. I won't go into too much detail on that. Personally, also I prefer bar graphs over pie charts. So, So I think yesterday Shamilji discussed the Edward Hickey. He shared the book with you guys. It's the best resource probably available right now on information design. It's a very old resource also, but very good to understand the theories behind it also. One theory that he proposes is called the data ink ratio, in which he assigns data ink as the ink that is being used on the graph that depicts data. and everything else is non-data kind of input. So everything that's useful is data in on the graph. So that what we aim to always do is maximize the amount of data input being used and minimize the amount of non-data input. So everything that's there on your paper or there on your computer is relevant to the person who's reading it. It's the only important information that should be there. So data ink ratio he proposes is like data ink divided by the ink, total ink used to print the graphic. There's further like mathematical thing also about it, but you can always check that out on the websites.
But it's not possible to have information overload there.
Information overload. So yeah, that's one of the criticisms that also has been come up. But I think this also means that we are trying to reduce the overload, right? We're trying to only give out information that is absolutely necessary, not creating like lines or elements additionally just so that it may look aesthetically a little more pleasing, but making sure that we're giving at least the most concise way of explaining something. I'll share an example about it also. So this like a kind of classic way of explaining data ink ratio. So the first graph on this on the right side that you see, left side. So see is the usual way of say representing a graph. You have bars. There are two bars. One is showing you actual budget. Actual whatever achievement of the finance, and the second one is the budgeted one, and they keep repeating that for 2013, 14, 15 and 16. On the side is a scale that tells you the quantity, and the second one that you see, the graph has kind of reduced the amount of elements. So the scale has been reduced. We used to have 2, 3, 4, 5, we now have 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. So, but it's still means the same, right? People can still understand what the quantity is going to be. The actual and budget that was being repeated has been now reduced. So that was redundant completely because I've already told you it's that. You know it's going to be the same thing for the rest of them also. So the timeline of course remains the same. The bars have been brought closer together and they're sticking to each other, but there's color difference. So you know which is actual and which is budget. But here what was happening, because there were so many lines, it was getting a little difficult to perceive the information. This second example makes it much more clearer for anybody to capture what's the point. The third and the fourth example reduce things further. And the fourth example I'll talk about simply as use color in order to kind of show that this was this year's data and these are the comparisons that we need to make from the previous years. And again, they've kind of made it highlighted, so like least amount of redundant data and most amount of data that you actually need to know. Okay, so one quick warning about always using graphs and pie charts is that don't try to use distorted views or ambiguity in the graphs. 3D things may not always be helpful to read. So especially in the cases of say pie charts and bar graphs, it may look like it's stylistically a little better or something, but you have to always give priority to the data or information that you're trying to convey. So this kind of skews the view of the percentages. So just to do a quick recap, when you're designing a infographic, you form a narrative, be mindful of the bias, choose a format based on the type of data and purpose. Explore ways of representation outside of the formats. So, I mean, I've given you a list, but you may not stick to it. You can always try something completely out of the format. Try something on your own altogether. Minimize the redundant elements and evaluate the visualization based on effective and clear communication. So there are some of the resources, some kind of books that you can try and go through if you want. We've also listed it. But, and there's something about flowing data, which gives very good examples of contemporary visualizations these days. There's another website called Explain, which is not here, which can be used for visual thinking as well as for infographics. Yeah, this is it. Okay, so we may take a short break right now or so we can maybe try and make groups now and maybe we'll shuffle a little bit and what we can do is we get info sheets for everybody and there are two choices that we have. One is I have some quantitative data available, a little old government data, but you can use that to make, say, draw some kind of a concept of what kind of graph it could use. And then if you want, you can use Inkscape to progress on that as well. The second option is if you feel you want to take up a Wikipedia page and want to visualize a page in the form of an infographic and that would be useful for you to upload, then we can try that as well.
Ask to draw it first.
Yeah, so we'll in either of the cases we're drawing first and then moving on to drawing. The drawing has to be very basic, it will be just conceptual, just thinking about it before moving to the computer.
So many these tools which are available online to create infographics, like software programs or web-based applications, is there any problem with that in the sense that they don't create SVG or something?
So, I mean the tools I have shared actually don't really tell you, don't create things for you. These are just resources.
No, there are software which create.
Yeah, otherwise there are.
Which give you templates, for example.
Yeah.
Choice
yeah.
of templates. Then what
I
is the?
I have a list of those as well, but I have not found a perfect one that will give you a good like SVG kind of.
Pictogram and something.
Yeah. But we can check on that.
Because like it takes out the design element and